hopeful and expectant 2020 was going to be an awesome year. Well, we know what really happened. But, you know, God can redeem anything in any situation, any year. And so 2021 Amen. Is going to be awesome. We just need to claim it. Amen. Let's open up with the Lord of Prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, God. And we just thank you, Lord, for your presence here, because we're two or three are gathered in your name. You are with us also. Lord, we just want to bring you honor and glory and praise today with every word said, every song sung. In Jesus' name, amen.
Never runs dry. Drink of the water. Come and Feet.
on with scripture, because I will most likely mess up what I'm going to say, but you can't mess up the word of God. Make it 2 Corinthians 3, verse 3 through 6 says, clearly, you are a letter from Christ, showing the result of our ministry among you. This letter is written not with pen and ink, but with the Spirit of the living God. That's the name of this song, the Spirit of the living God. It is carved not on tablets of stone, but on human hearts. We are confident of all this because of our great trust in God through Christ. It is not that we think we are qualified to do anything on our own. Our qualification comes from God. He has enabled us to be ministers of His new covenant. This is a covenant not of written laws, but of the Spirit. The old written covenant ends in death, but under the new covenant, the Spirit gives life. And then later on in that same chapter, verses 17 and 18, for the Lord is the Spirit. And wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So all of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image.
Spirit of the living God, Spirit of
Spirit of the living God is what changes us. Help us as we begin this new year, Jesus, that you would change us and change our desires and change our hearts to seek what you seek, to desire what you desire, Jesus. Help that to be our priority. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Outstanding, ladies. Amen. Praise the Lord. Good morning, Vision Church. It sure is good to see all of you here this morning. Amen. I hope everybody had a good Christmas. Amen. Good, good. We had a good one as well. Had all the family at home. Always a blessing to have that, amen? So we're glad to have them and got to spend some time with Mom and Dad and Garrett and Alyssa down. Savannah killed her a buck on Christmas night, Christmas Eve. And so it's been a good season, amen. And get to kind of wind it up with you guys here this morning. So, amen, it's been a good Christmas, amen. Anybody have anything they want to share with us this morning? Answered prayer or praise report, anything? Wow. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Trudy. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Brother Law? Okay. All right. Anyone? Yes, sir. Amen. All right. Sure. Certainly will. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am. Okay. All right. That's David's father, right? Right. Okay. All right. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
And just keep remembering my mom.
Okay. All right. Certainly will. Yes, ma'am.
The PMS baby, he passed away on Christmas Day.
Okay. All right. All right. Anybody else? All right, we have a lot of unspoken requests. Amen. Let's all stand. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Join me as we pray. Father, we're so grateful, Lord, to be in your house, Lord, to be able to celebrate this season. Lord, thank you so much, Lord, for each and every person, every family that's here today. Lord, just give you the praise for it right now. Thank you so much, Lord, for touching these prayer requests as Trudy has made mention of this morning, Lord. Lord, we just give you all the praise and all the glory for it, Lord. Certainly, Lord, your hand is not too short that you're not able to reach out and touch those lives, Lord. Lord, your strength is phenomenal. You certainly are almighty. Lord, so we give you the praise and the glory for what you're doing. We continue to lift up that need to you, Father. Pray that you're going to bring it to a completion, Lord. And Lord, we pray, Lord, for many of the others that We know of our family members, extended family members, people that you've placed on our heart that don't know you. We continually lift them up to you, Lord, asking you to draw them to yourself, Lord. We know that you're not willing any would perish, but all would come to repentance. Lord, we pray your will, Lord, that you draw them to yourself, Lord. Save them, redeem them, Lord. Give them an eternity in heaven, we pray in Christ's name. We pray for these that have lost loved ones. As Kelly's mentioned, we ask you, Lord, to comfort those families in Jesus' name. Pray for those that are sick. Ask you, God, to touch their body, bring healing to them in Christ's name. Jesus, you are the great physician. So, Lord, when we lift up a person to you, we're bringing that person to you. Lord, we're bringing them to the one who can meet that need, heal that body, touch that life. Lord, we pray that you would do so, and we ask it in your precious name. Lord, we ask, Lord, for all those other needs that are out there. God, you know what they are, whatever they may be. Whether it be some relational issues, personal, physical issues, those waiting on doctor's reports, whatever they may be, Lord, pray that you would answer those in just the right and perfect way, God, in Christ's name. We'll pray for those that are overcoming surgery. We ask you to bless them in Jesus' name. Pray for our missionaries that are in foreign fields. We pray, God, for your favor to shine upon them. Thank you, Lord, for the efforts and the contribution that they did in those places, Father, that brought Christmas to many that couldn't experience otherwise. Thank you for those that gave toward that need. And Lord, help you. I pray, God, that you'd help us as a church continue to be an avenue for that, Lord. And we just pray, God, that you would be with us this morning as we continue in this service. Thank you so much for our worship team and the time and the effort that they put in it, God, in order to help us lift up your name in praise and lift you up in worship. Lord, pray that you continue to bless them and anoint them, Lord, for what they do. And we pray that our praise and worship, that it was pleasing in your sight, God. And thank you so much, God, for the good times that we had with our friends and family over this time. Pray for those that are dealing with the coronavirus. Ask you, God, to help them to get over it. Pray that they wouldn't be spreading it. Pray for the family members that are trying to help them, protect them in Christ's name. We lift up Peyton to you. Ask you, Lord, to continue to bring healing to this young child in Jesus' name. Help Kelly and her family, Father. We thank you so much for it. And Lord, as we continue on this morning, we pray for your anointing, for your blessing in Jesus' name. Thank you for all those that give and for giving the tithe. Pray that your blessing would be upon that tither. And thank you so much for it. All that you do for us, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people have said, amen. Amen. Amen.
Can do. We're asking you to make next year into something beautiful. God, make next year about hope and healing and reconciliation and progress. Make next year about your word and your love and your mission and your power. Next year, turn our weakness into strength. Turn our tears into a song. Turn our pain into laughter. And turn our scars into a story. A story of your mercy and grace. Make next year about you. In your glory. In your fame. Not ours. Your kingdom come, your will be done. Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, guys, if you have your Bible this morning, and I hope you do, kids are going out, young people with Bailey. Thank the Lord for them and the ministry they do Sunday morning and Wednesday evening. Amen. So blessed to have them. We're going to be in the book of Colossians this morning. So turn, if you will, to Colossians 13:81 in my Bible. If you're joining us by way of live stream, it's really good to have you, whether Facebook Live or YouTube Live. It's so great for you to join us in that way. Amen. We are in the last Sunday before 2021. So Sunday morning, if you don't come Wednesday night, if it's next Sunday, we'll already be into the new year. And, you know, part of every new year and the closing of the previous year, we kind of look back on that year. Like today, we're looking back on 2020. And probably we have made some decisions earlier in the year, and we're hoping that things would be improved and better toward the end of the year, right where we're at now. So many of us might have made some personal adjustments or wanted to. We call them resolutions. Maybe physical, could have been, and I hope spiritual, could have been relational, even financial. All kind of different things, aspects of our life that we encounter. And, you know, we decided in 2019, at the end of it, that we wanted 2020 to be better. Now, no one of us could saw what would have happened in 2020. Amen? Amen. No one of us had any idea it was going to be like that. But there are some aspects that we still could have made some adjustments to. And so I ask you today, you know, as we're here at the very close of 2020, how'd you do? Those things that you wanted to improve on today, have they been improved? How'd you do? And I don't see too many people nodding or anything like that, so I don't really know what to say. Everybody's kind of quiet and stoic, so I don't know. It didn't go, okay? It might not have. It might have done good, you know. If it did, praise the Lord. If not, then guess what? We're at the close of 2020, and we're all hoping that 2021 is going to be a better year, amen? And I'm hoping that it will. I don't know. I have no idea. I'm certainly not a prophet. And I do not claim to be. But, you know, we need to hope for the best, but also prepare for what we know the Bible tells us. The Bible tells us that in the end times, perilous times are going to come. Amen. Okay, I'm hoping it's going to be a better year, but we need to prepare ourselves just in case it's not. Amen? And understand that the Bible, God is bringing about His perfect will, just like the Bible says. Amen? Right. Well, in that examination that we do, perhaps we're making some plans for this coming year, whether it be New Year's resolutions, you know, for 2021, whether it be some adjustments. And we might be doing some of those same things. We're examining, okay, maybe I want to be a little bit more healthy by this time next year. Maybe I want to lose a few pounds. Maybe I want to put on some muscle. Maybe I want to have read through the Bible by this time. How many of you, by the way, how many of you planning on reading through the Bible this year? Okay. Your hands ought to be more than that, okay? All right, that's very disappointing, okay? I'm sorry. It ought to be every one of your resolutions to read through the Bible this year, okay? I'm making a resolution. I want you to join me, okay? How many of you will join me, okay? All right? Now, I'm going to remind you about that, so I'm going to ask you how you're doing, and I want you to ask me, okay? All right, let's keep each other accountable, amen? Now, did you realize, you know, that there's all kinds of ways to read the Bible? You can do it, of course, electronically, on your phone. There's apps for that. There's Bibles you can buy. There's ways that you can figure it out on your own. You know, you don't have to have some way to do it. You can actually read a passage in the Old Testament and go start in Genesis, and by this time next year, you're pretty close to Revelation 22. You could read some Old Testament and some New Testament, some Psalms and some Proverbs. You know, that's usually the way that those programs are put out there. So whichever way that you decide to do it, I encourage you to do it. Amen? Some of you probably got new Bibles for Christmas. Put that thing into use, and I promise you will not regret it, okay? I know it's going to be hard whenever you go through the book of Numbers and the book of Leviticus. When you get to a lot of those genealogies, it's going to be tough, but you know, persevere, amen? Persevere. You can make it, and I promise you will not be sorry, amen? By this time next year, you know, you'll be able to say, I read through the entire Bible. Didn't think I could do it. I read through the entire Bible. And you know, not a lot of people have done that. Amen? So be one of those who can say that they did. Amen? So I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to keep you accountable. I want you to keep me accountable as well. Amen? I come across a list of resolutions, and hopefully this will be some things that'll put a smile on your face. I don't know. A lot of times, you know, our resolutions are about weight, you know, losing weight, you know, you're losing a few pounds. I want you to listen to some of these. These are 10 diet and weight loss resolutions. Y'all ready? Okay. Amen. Yeah. All right. You might want to add them down. I don't know if you do or not. Okay. Lose weight by hiding it somewhere. You'll never find it. Gain enough weight to get on The Biggest Loser. Buy new clothes big enough to account for next year's holidays. Don't do this one now. Start smoking to lose weight. Lose weight by inventing an anti-gravity machine. Lose weight by living on the moon. Find a more accurate scale, because, you know, yours is probably way off, right? Amen? Build biceps by increasing reps of ding-dong curls from 3 to 15 sets, okay? Stop buttering your donuts and eat more fruit, ... snacks, okay? Here's something about money. Pay off my credit cards every month in full with my other credit cards. Not a good idea, okay? Save some money for a rainy day. That way I can shop online instead of having to go to an actual store. Keep better records throughout the year. That way I can listen to better music while I'm trying to figure up my taxes. Look for investors for my home office business. That's pretty good. Lower my bills by digging a hole to put them in. Borrow things more often, return them less often. Some of us have been on both sides of that, haven't we? Buy a fire extinguisher, JB, so that your money won't burn a hole in your pocket. And then stop throwing away money that could at least be burned for heat. All right. Well, we ought to have some spiritual resolutions as well. Amen. And that's what we're going to be talking about this morning. In the book of Colossians, Colossians chapter 1, we're going to be looking at seven prayers for the new year. Seven prayers for the new year. Or you could actually put it seven items to pray for, seven things to pray for. Actually, what we're going to be looking at is one prayer of Paul's, but it actually has seven elements in it. And so these are things that we can pray for ourselves, things that we can pray for others, and things that you can pray for me. I hope you pray for me. I know some of you do. I hope all of you are praying for me. I pray for you guys, believe it or not. I pray for you. I call you by name, and I mention your request. I pray for you, pray for God's blessing on you. I remember the needs that you have, and I pray for those. Sometimes I may not remember the exact name of the person that you mentioned, but God knows it. Amen. Lord, you know the need that they brought up, that person that needs that touch, that healing, that deliverance, needs saving. Lord, touch them in Jesus' name. So I pray for you guys. I encourage you, and I covet your prayers from me. Now, there's some times that we don't know really how to pray. Amen? Sometimes, you know, people will ask me, hey, would you pray that I get this job? Hey, will you pray that... that, you know, I find this relationship with this person, that they'll start liking me and stuff like that. Hey, I'm not going to pray that for you, because I don't know if that'll ruin you. That job may be just enough to push you over the edge and get you so much money that you don't even need God no more, or you think you don't, and, you know, you fall away. So I don't know if that's what God wants me to pray for you or not. So what I pray, Lord, whatever your will is for them in this situation, for their job hunt, Lord, let your will be done. In the relationship, Lord, you know what they need. You know the person that's out there for them. Lord, bring that person into their life, okay? So if you ask me to pray specifically like that, hey, I don't know God's particular will for that situation, so I'm not going to necessarily pray that you win the lotto, okay? Amen? Are you following me? Amen. But these are things that we're going to be looking at that you can pray, even for people that you don't know. See, the Colossians here, the letter to we call Colossians is actually a letter to a church at Colossae. It's written by the Apostle Paul, and Paul had never even been to Colossae. He'd never met these people. What Paul was doing around the time that this church was started, he was down in his headquarters in Ephesus. He spent about 3 years there. And there was a guy by the name of Epaphras who come down to where Paul was preaching and building this church in Ephesus, and he learned from Paul. Paul poured into this person, Epaphras. And Epaphras was from Colossae, so he went back to his home after having learned from Paul, and it seemed to have started this little church called the church at Colossae. We call the letter the letter of the Colossians, because the people there, that's their place that they were. But Paul never went there. He never visited there. Now, about probably 4 or 5 years later, Paul was in prison in Rome at the time of this writing, And Epaphras came to visit Paul in Rome, in prison, to try to comfort him, try to encourage him, try to, you know, help him in some ways that he possibly could. And at that time, Epaphras starts telling Paul about some issues that the church at Colossae is having. You know, when you got people, there's going to be issues, amen? And so he's letting them know, look, there's some problems here, Paul, at the church. And there's some problems with, you know, with this particular issue there. And so he tells Paul these things. Paul, this is called a prison epistle because Paul writes it in prison. And he sends it back by, you know, a guy we'll just call O, because he's got a really tough name. You can read through the scripture and you'll find it, okay? But not a name you want to give your kids, all right? He sends it back by Mr. O to get back to that church there in Colossae, and we have it here today. Things that Paul had heard about from Epaphras, things that the Holy Spirit had dropped into Paul's heart that they needed to have. And so what did Paul do? Paul began to pray for them. And so this is an outstanding prayer, a prayer that you can pray for yourself. As we go through it today, this morning, you're going to see some things, hopefully, that, man, I would love for that to be for me. Well, guess what? Pray this prayer. I would love that be for my children or for my parents, my siblings, my friends, my coworkers. I would love for this to be for them. So pray this prayer. Go ahead and mark it, you know, put a tab by it, if you will. Take your pen and mark this as we're going through that. Pray this for yourself if you think you need it. And I'm pretty certain that you do. We all do. Pray it for me because I certainly need it. And pray it for those people like Paul that you may not even ever have known, ever have met, but you've heard about them. Perhaps people are bringing their name up in church or something. And I don't know them, but I can pray for them. You can pray this as well. Amen? So look at it with me, if you will. Come on down to verse 9. Colossians chapter 1, verse 9. Does everybody have it? Amen? For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. And then he's going to talk about the very first thing on our list. But I want to stop there. Paul says, we've not stopped praying for you. Again, Paul had never been to Colossae, never met the people. All he had was what the Holy Spirit was dropping in his heart, what Epaphras was telling him. And what did Paul do? Immediately, he started praying. And the Bible says that he never stopped praying for them. See, prayer is not to be a one-time thing. You don't just pray something and you don't get it, you know, in 10 minutes. You say, well, forget that. No, you keep praying. Amen. Do you remember the words of Jesus? Jesus said this. He says, ask, seek, and knock. Amen. For the one that asks, guess what? They're given something. They're given a request. You know, they're answered. For the one that knocks, the door is open. For the one that seeks, they're going to find. Now, in that language, he's not talking about a one-time ask or a one-time knock or a one-time seeking. In the language that Jesus is speaking, it's keep on knocking. You know, if you don't want to go to the door, but somebody keeps on knocking, you know, before long, you're going to go to that door. You may be mad as all can be, but, you know, you're going to go to the door. So they'll quit knocking, right? He says, hey, keep on asking. Those times when your kids would ask you for something and ask and ask and ask and ask and ask, and you finally, just because you got wore out, you gave in, right? Okay, he's not talking about being aggravated at us because God doesn't get aggravated. He wants us to be there whenever we are speaking to him, when we're asking and seeking and knocking. Guess what? We are having communion with God. That's what he's after. Amen. That's what he's after, that relationship with you and me. And he knows if we just come one time and ask, you know, he may not hear from us another time, you know, that whole month. Amen. But if we continually seek, if we continually knock, if we continually ask, what am I doing? I'm continually there before the throne. I'm continually talking to God. And you know, it may be that what God wants to do is not change a situation, not change the other people. He may want to change you. Maybe that's what needs to change. You know what? When we're in the presence of God, that's what happens. We start to examine things. Why isn't this answered? Why isn't this happening? Maybe I need to make some adjustments. All these things, you know, take time. You know, we don't get exactly what we want when we pray. We start, okay, what's wrong? Maybe I didn't pray long enough. Maybe I didn't pray hard enough. Maybe I didn't read the scriptures. You know, we start examining our life and we say, what can I do to get this answer? Yeah. And then we get to that place sometimes where God will drop it in our spirit. You know, maybe it's you. Amen. And it starts to resonate with us. Maybe it is me. Maybe I need to, you know, look at things a little different. Maybe I need to be a little bit more forgiving. Maybe I need to be a little bit more patient, okay? I'm praying that for others, but maybe it's really on my side. And, you know, when that starts to take place, you know what? we start to see that answer coming through in certain situations. Amen? So praise the Lord for that. So I encourage you, pray for yourself continually. Pray for me continually. Let's pray for each other. Keep on praying. Keep on asking, seeking, and knocking. Amen? So that's what Paul does. He says, since we've heard, we have not stopped praying for you. And then here's number one. Are you ready? You got a pen or a pencil? If you're a note taker, if you're a scribbler, amen? Write these down. We have not stopped asking God to fill you with the knowledge of His will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. Amen. The first thing on Paul's list that he was praying for the Colossians, the first thing that we may say what we need, but I'm telling you, it's what I need. The people that we don't know, it's what they need, is to fill us with the knowledge of His will. Amen. Did you realize that God has a will?
Amen. Come on.
What's the word will? What does that mean? Well, will is really what you want. It's our will corresponds with our wants. If I was to say, hey, I'm writing you a blank check, giving you, you know, all the resources you need, and you got the time to fulfill it, what is it that you would want? Some of you would say, oh, I want to go to the Bahamas. I want to go to, you know, Antarctica. I want to go to the Himalayas. I want to go to the beach, down to Hawaii somewhere. Somebody would say, I want to go to I don't know where. And we lay those things out. Those are our wishes. Those are our wants, our desires. And if I could get whatever it is I want, then I would have it. You know, I told you guys, you probably don't remember, but I told my sister, I said, she asked me what I wanted for Christmas, so I sent her a picture. David, it was like a 2018 Corvette. It had been wrecked on the front, okay, white and black. I sent it to her. I only wanted $20,000 for it, you know. So I figured, you know, I could spend some time, you know, because that's kind of some things I like to do, you know, work on it and make it nice. So I sent that to her, you know, because she's got the resources. I know it. Well, guess what? I got my Corvette Christmas morning. I got it. I'm serious. I got it. The same color, everything, white with some black trim. Canaan, it was there, brand new. The only problem was a little bit too small for me to crawl in. It was about this long, okay? But JB, it had a lifetime warranty. It said so on the box, amen? That would be my will. What would be my will? If I could get anything I want for Christmas, you know, be a brand new Corvette, wouldn't that be awesome? I mean, if you join me in that wish, amen? All right. That's our will. That's our wish. And we've got those things about ourselves, you know. We know what we want. You know, sometimes we vocalize it, sometimes we don't. But, you know, what is that? Our will. You know, I will do this. I will go after that. I will have that. You know, that's our will. Hopefully it don't surprise you, but you need to know it if it does. God has a will for us. Yeah. It's God's will for you. It's God's will for me. You see, God has created you and I for His good pleasure, the Bible says.
Amen.
We were created to please God. Now, that may be a revelation for some of you this morning. But that's why God, He created us.
Yes,
there is a plan and a purpose that God has for each one of us. I talk to many people during the course of a week. And, you know, one of the things I ask them, if I see someone that's in college or, you know, high school, hey, what's your plans? And, you know, a lot of them had it already figured out. You know, well, I want to go, you know, to Auburn or Alabama. I want to go to South. I want to go to University of Mobile. And, you know, I want to study engineering. I want to study, you know, graphic design. I want to study, you know, architecture. All these things. They got it all figured out. And then I want to get a job. I want to get a job with GM. I want to get a job with Tesla. I want to get a job, you know, with this computer firm. And those are the plans that they have for themselves. And we as parents, you know, we've got plans for our kids too. We want to help them accomplish those good things. Amen?
Amen?
Well, you know, God told Jeremiah, He said, I know the plans that I have for you.
Amen.
Jeremiah, they are good and not evil.
Amen.
God's plan for me, God's plan for you is not an evil plan.
Amen.
It's a good plan.
Amen.
He said, they're good and not evil. Plans to give you a future and a hope.
Yes.
God has a plan for you. He's got a purpose for you.
Amen.
He created you for that purpose.
Amen.
That's the way you're exactly like you are, so you can fulfill that plan of purpose. That's why you're born in this particular time. That's where you're alive in 2020, fixing to be in 2021. That's why you were born in your generation to your parents. That's why you have the level of income that you have. That's why you have the talents. That's why you have the giftings that you have. That's why the propensities that you have. That's why they're there. God has picked fixed all those things together, put them in a blend, and made you. And there is no one else in this entire world that's just like you.
Amen.
And God, along with that mix, your personality, put it all in there. And in that mix, God has said, this is what I want that person to do. I want Trudy to do this. I want JB to do that. I want Kelly to do this. And I've given them all that they need to do it.
Amen.
And I've created them just for that. That's my plan, and that's my purpose for them. And you see, God has that for each and every one of us. And what Paul is praying for these Christians that are here in Colossae, he said, I'm praying that you be filled with the knowledge of His will, God's will. Fill. If you're going to fill something, there needs to be a void, correct? You can't fill something that's already full, yes? That implies if there's a void, you know, another word for void we might say is emptiness. You know, there's a lot of empty people out there.
Amen.
Amen. You encounter them, I encounter them. There's some emptiness there. A lot of times you'll hear, you know, portrayed like this, you know, I just don't know what I'm going to do. I just don't know, you know, about this situation. I don't know how I'm going to make it. I don't know what I'm going to do in this situation. What is that implying again? It's implying there's a lack of knowledge.
Amen.
You say, Rick, that's knowledge. What did they say? I just don't know. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know how the situation is going to work out. What they don't have is the knowledge. Amen? They said, I don't know. Or we would say knowledge. Amen? Y'all with me? Amen? Wake up. Paul said, I want you to have the knowledge of God's will. I want you to be filled with that knowledge.
Amen.
And you see, whenever we are in this life and we're not aware that God has will for us, a plan and a purpose, we're going to go through this life in seeking other things to try to fill up that emptiness that's there, you know? And we're going to add this and add this and add that and add this, you know? And it may work temporarily, but there's still going to be that emptiness, you know? And we're going to try to fill that void, fill that emptiness with things, activities, perhaps relationships or people, finances, whatever. And there's still, it lasts for a little while, but then there's continually that gnawing that something's just not complete. You know, Paul realizes that about these people. You've realized that about yourself before you found the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And we realize that what the Lord has for us is a plan, is a purpose that's uniquely fitted for me, for you.
Yes,
and only you or I can do that.
Amen.
And so we realize that that's why we're here. So many people today would say, I don't even know why I'm here, why I'm alive, why I even exist. I'm telling you why you exist, why you're alive, why you're here. For God's pleasure, for God's purpose, to accomplish it in this world.
Amen.
That's why you're here. That's why you exist. That's why you're still breathing. It's because God has a plan and a purpose for your life. And He wants you to get involved with it. First of all, for you to get involved with it, you got to know it.
Amen.
You got to know it. Some of us maybe perhaps didn't know that God has a plan. Perhaps you do know that God has a plan. Maybe you even are of the opportunity or of the attitude rather that I don't really want to get involved with God's plan because it'll mess my plan all up. It you know, all of my things, and I've got, you know, this and this, and if I got all laid out pretty nicely, Rick, and if I get involved with God's plan, it's just going to wreck all that.
Yeah.
It's going to mess it all up, and my life will be ruined.
Yeah.
It's just going to be all lost.
Okay.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Guys, the Bible speaks about that, about the person that's building a house out of different material.
Yeah.
And for the person that says, I'm not going to do what God says, I'm just going to build my house my way, my plan, my purpose. The Bible speaks about that person building out of wood, hay, and stubble.
Amen.
And you see, at the end of life, whenever it's before the bema seat of Christ, and that person's life works. Did you hear me? Their life works. All the things that they've done accumulated up in this life. You know, at the end of time, as they stand before Christ as a believer, those works, those things that they poured their life into, their effort, their sweat, you know, their finances, their time, those things are going to be tried by the fire of Christ. And if they're wood, hay, and stubble, they're just going to perish.
Yeah.
And that person there, even though they're saved and they're in heaven, they're going to be a pauper.
Yeah.
They're going to be bankrupt in heaven. Can you imagine that? Why? Because even though they're saved, even though they're in heaven, man, they've wasted their entire life.
Yeah.
because they didn't realize that God had a plan and a purpose for them. They didn't realize that His will was for them to do this with their life. And so they spent their life skirting the responsibilities and the plan of God, and yet building a house like they wanted to, and yet it had no eternal value. Yeah, it's fine here. It's fine in this existence. It's perfect here. Maybe it's, you know, it's the envy of everybody. But in eternity, it has no significant value, and it's all burned up. Yeah, there are those that do get involved with the will of God. And they start building their house. And the Bible says about those people that they build it with gold, silver, and precious stones. And so at the end of time, guess what? The fire of Christ ignites that. And you know what happens whenever you take gold, silver, precious stone and put it through the refiner's fire? It doesn't burn up. It gets better. All the dross, all the waste is burned up. It gets finer. It gets refined. Amen? And you see, that's the person that realizes, the believer that says, you know, God's got a plan. He's got a purpose that's much greater than mine. And it's got eternal significance. You know? Not just for these, you know, 70 that David says we're going to be here, but for eternity, forever and ever. Yeah, we're saved. And we enter into eternity, not a pauper, but someone who's got some gold and silver and precious stones that have come from living a life, going and working according to God's plan and God's purpose. Amen? Oh, guys, I want that for all of us. I want us all, when we get up into heaven, into eternity, and our works are brought before the Lord, that those things are going to be found to be pleasing to the Lord. Amen? You should want that for yourself. Want that for your family. Want that for your kids, your parents. Amen? We don't talk enough about this, you know. But just getting into heaven may be the goal for some people. And they say, well, that's all I care about. Well, you're going to be in heaven, but there's no rewards. All the rewards have been burnt up. That's not how you want to spend eternity. Amen? Oh, praise God. Thank you, Lord. Look what he says. The knowledge of his will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. Two things. I want you to have the knowledge of God's will through spiritual wisdom and spiritual understanding. Amen. Wisdom. What is wisdom? Wisdom, of course, is something like we would find in the book of Proverbs. Proverbs written by Solomon, the third king of Israel, David's son. The wisest and probably the most wealthy person ever lived, even by today's standards. Solomon wrote down in this letter, in this book called the Wisdom Book, or the book of you know, Proverbs, is a book about practical wisdom. You see, the person that Paul is speaking about here, when he says, I want you to be filled with the knowledge of his will, with all wisdom and understanding, he's talking about the person who's got their feet planted on the ground. That's practical wisdom. But their head is facing up toward heaven. Amen. And so their feet are on the ground. Their eyes and their ears are faced toward the Lord, where they can hear the heart of God. And hearing the heart of God, that's that understanding, that spiritual understanding. But we also need to have that spiritual wisdom. How do I translate that into my daily walk? Because I'm a person, really, of two worlds. My home is in heaven, but I'm stuck here on this earth for right now. So how do I take the plan of God, the will of God, and really put it in, you know, where the rubber meets the road, we might say, where the feet touch the ground, you know, in everyday living? That's what the book of Proverbs is about, guys. Amen. And since I spoke earlier about reading the Bible, you know, the book of Proverbs has 30 chapters. You can read a chapter a day for a month and be read through the entire book of Proverbs in 1 month. If you do that 12 times each month, guess what? You have read through the Bible, through the book of Proverbs 12 times at the end of the year. That's amazing. And I promise you this, guys, you will be a wiser person, much wiser, having read one time, six times, 12 times. Think about it. This time next year, if you read through, and it'll take very long, one chapter a day, Proverbs. You read it through 12 times, you perhaps might be the one that people are coming to for advice. Amen? Because you're so wise. I'm promising you, guys, if you will put an effort into reading the book of Proverbs, man, you will find that wisdom that's so practical for daily living, something that we need. And I'm telling you, you'll be pleased that you started on that endeavor. If you want to read through the book of Psalms, Psalms has 150 chapters, you know. You can read through 5 chapters a day, read through the entire book of Psalms in a month. Amen? Do the same thing with it. Giving you some hints, and I don't see anybody writing them down, all right? Trying to help you, God, but I promise you, the book of Psalms is all about praise and worship and adoration of God. Amen. Book of Proverbs about taking the knowledge of God and putting it into practical terms. That's what Paul was praying for these guys. He said, I want you to have that spiritual understanding. Understanding the heart of God, hearing what that is. My head's up in the clouds. I'm looking up toward heaven, but my feet are firmly planted on the ground, and I'm doing my life according to what God wants me to do, and I'm carrying it out through this wisdom that I'm gaining through His Word.
Amen.
Amen? How many of you would love to have that? I would love to have that. Please pray that for me. Amen? That's number one. All right, so number two. Verse 10, look at it with me. And we pray this in order that you may have a life worthy of the Lord. So the first thing is that you know God's will. You be filled with the knowledge of His will and all spiritual understanding and wisdom. And then number two, taking that and putting it into practice that you might have a life worthy, what does he say? A life worthy of the Lord. Man, that's a high calling. That is a super high calling. You mean my life could be a life worthy of the Lord? What's he talking about there, Rick? I heard someone probably a couple of months ago, a parent, and they kind of accidentally found out something that one of their children had did. And it wasn't very flattering. And when they found out, they said, oh, no, oh, no, we're not going to do that. And then they called their family name. You know, we are... You know, if it was me, I would say, we are hearts, and hearts aren't going to be involved in that. Okay? That's the family name. Oh, no, that's not going to get it right there. And they took steps right away to rectify that situation. I was talking with a good lifelong friend of mine the other day, and we were talking about some things with our kids and stuff, and they made mention of something that his son was doing, you know, with a vehicle. And I told him, I said, you know, Savannah, she can change her own oil, she can change her tire, she can work on her own car, she knows how to do all that. And he said, well, of course, she's a heart. She's a heart. Okay? You know, we've been brought up that way. My daddy instilled that into me, and I tried to instill that into my kids, you know? And it's a pleasure when you see that. What am I talking about? I'm talking about carrying on that tradition or something that is congruent to that name.
Amen.
Alexander the Great, you've heard of that guy, right?
Yeah.
Okay? After a battle one day, he confronted one of his soldiers. He noticed that soldier was a little bit, he was a little bit less active to engage, meaning that he didn't really want to enter into the fight. He was a little bit, you know, reclusive in that sense. And so he cornered that soldier, Alexander did. And he said, soldier, what's your name? And there's a lot of people around him, you know, and he was very timid. He said, Alexander, sir, just like yours. Alexander the Great looked at that young man who wasn't willing to engage. He said, soldier, change your behavior or change your name. Why? Because he carried the same name as Alexander the Great. And he said, you know, we're not going to do this. you're not going to have this name here, and you're timid and not willing to engage in the battle. So either change your behavior, get it more in line with me, your commander, or change your name. Man, that just preaches all day long because
Amen.
Who are we? What's your name?
Amen.
Christian?
Yes.
Child of God?
Amen.
We have to ask ourselves then, okay, how is my life, the life I'm living, how congruent is it with the name?
Yes.
He says that you may live a life worthy of the name. Your walk, your life, you know, what we do outside of these four walls. You know, when people see that life, you know, is this lived out? Would people say about us? Would they say about me? Would they say about you? You know, that person, that's a Christian. That's a Christian. Why? Because I see what they do and what they don't do. You know, there's some things that Christians should be doing. And there's a lot of things Christians shouldn't be doing. Amen? And, you know, the world, we may think that the world really doesn't take notice, but, you know, they do. They really do. And, you know, they see us. I wonder what they would say, you know, concerning me, concerning you. Would they say about that person, oh, I know that person's a Christian? Or would they be shocked to find out that you were a Christian? That would be really bad, wouldn't it?
Amen.
You know, they expect, well, Christian, I know where they're going to be a Sunday morning. They're not going to be home. They're going to be in church. I know what they're going to be doing, you know, because they're Christian. things that they're doing, things that, that the Bible says about them that we're supposed to be doing, like praying, reading our Bible, worshiping the Lord, loving the Lord, loving others, being forgiving, being patient, being kind, being long-suffering, having love and joy and peace. You know, all of the attributes there that are found in Galatians chapter 5, 22, the fruit of the Spirit. All that part of our life. You know, are we really portraying that? You know, but there's also some things that we know Christians shouldn't be doing. Amen?
Amen.
You know, you wouldn't expect the person that's a Christian to be out clubbing, be out, you know, getting tied on a drunk, or cursing out someone. Amen? Are you following me? You know, carrying out some illicit relationship, all those kind of things. You know, those things just don't line up. And so we would say about those people, wherever we might find them, put them in a category, well, that's a Christian, because I see them living out their faith. That's what Paul is praying for these people here that are in Colossae. I pray that you walk worthy of the name, child of God, Christian, believer. That when others would see us out there in the world, they would know us, maybe not even by our personal name, but they would know that person, that Trudy Johnson, that lady's a Christian. Amen.
Amen?
Would to God that would be said about all of us. Amen? It wouldn't be something that's just kind of up in the air. I don't really know. Do you know if they're Christian? I don't really know if they're Christian or not. That should never be the case for any of us. Amen?
Amen?
That's what Paul's praying. He said, look, I want you to know the will of God. I want you to be filled with that knowledge of that will. I want you to have your feet planted on the ground, your head up in the air, understanding and taking that understanding and putting it in practical wisdom there as you live your life and walking that life that is congruent and pleasing to the Lord. How? Look what he says. That it may please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work. Bearing fruit. You know what it means to bear fruit? It means that something is planted, something is growing, it's alive, and when the time for the seeds to come and to germinate, or for the time for the tree to put on its fruit, that it's ready. You remember the time when Jesus cursed the fig tree? Y'all remember that?
Amen.
He saw this fig tree there, and you know, it had the leaves, which meant it should have had some fruit on it. It was some of the first things, you know, the early figs is what they would call them, refer to them as. Jesus went over there to that fig tree to get some of these early first figs, and there, he found none. You know what Jesus did? Jesus cursed that tree. He said, may no man eat from you ever again, forever. And then, you know, the next day the disciples saw this tree. You know, they heard what he said. They saw the tree, and they saw that it was dried up from the roots, meaning that it had a root problem. The language is technical there, meaning the problem wasn't on the outside, but the problem was where the roots were established. And Jesus, you see, cursed that tree, and the disciples were amazed that the tree was dried up from the roots the very next day. You say, well, was Jesus having a temper tantrum? Was Jesus just trying to be ugly? No, what Jesus was trying to say was, this is for me and you. That when Jesus comes to something, he expects to see some fruit. He expects to see some life. And that fruit would be pleasing to Jesus. Jesus went there to eat. He was hungry. He found that fig. If he could have found one, would have eaten it, would have pleased him. Jesus wants to come to our life. And he expects to find something that pleases him. You see, here's the bottom line. If our life doesn't please Jesus, it'll never please anybody else.
Amen.
Jesus, because there's no fruit there, he says, may no man eat fruit from you ever again. See, our first goal in life, our first objective is to please the Lord.
Amen.
And you see, if we don't please Jesus, then we're not going to please anybody else. If I'm not pleasing the Lord, I'm not going to please my wife or my children or you guys. Okay? I'm not going to please anybody. My co-workers, employees, I'm not going to please anybody. If my life is not pleasing to the Lord first, then it's not going to be pleasing to all the other peripherals out there. The same thing with you. If your life is not pleasing to the Lord, then there's no way it's going to be pleasing to other people. And that's the principle behind that cursing of the fig tree. But now if you remember in Genesis 49, whenever Jacob was pronouncing that prophecy over all of his children, he got to Joseph, who was his favorite son. And he said, Joseph is a fruitful vine, a vine planted by the water that has its fruit that is overhanging the wall. Amen. Have you ever seen a tree that was planted pretty close to somebody's property? Maybe you had a fence up there, and you know what? It grew up to such a tremendous height that it overhung their fence, and maybe it was on your side. You know, Mama used to have a big pear tree, and there's a fence right beside that pear tree, you know, a privacy-type fence. But now she had land on both sides. But, you know, that tree was so bountiful, that thing would bring such pears that the leaves and the branches would just be hanging in the ground. But there were some of them that would hang over that fence. And so you could get good pears on both sides, Trudy. You could go on one side and get a bunch of pears, but you could go also on the other side. And there was so many dropping on that because that was her driveway that her car would just squish all those pears. Amen. You know, that's what he's talking about Joseph. Joseph is a fruitful vine, a vine planted by the water. And his branches are so numerous and so plenteous that not only is it for him, but also for anybody else on the outside, across the fence, for other people. Are you following me? Amen. See, the tree that he's talking about, Joseph, pleasing to the Lord, but then it overhangs the fence. It lets other people eat from it as well. Amen. And that's what he's speaking about with me and you, that the Lord, a life pleasing to the Lord is able to come up to us and find something in our life that's pleasing. Amen. And then because we're pleasing the Lord, there's something else hanging over the fence. Amen. There's something on the outskirts there that other people can grab a hold of and be filled with it, find joy in it. Are you guys with me this morning? Amen. Amen. That's his prayer for you and me. Now, what are some things that are pleasing to the Lord? Well, the Lord, again, looks at our life. You know, praise and worship pleases the Lord. Amen. Did you guys realize that? In Isaiah chapter 43, verse 21, speaking about how that God has created us, you know, to worship him, to please him. Isaiah 43, 21. The people whom I have formed for myself, that they may declare my praise. The Lord says, I formed these people so that they can declare my praise. Amen. And you know John 4:23, Jesus there with a woman at the well. She's asking him, where should we worship? You worship in Jerusalem. We worship at Mount Gerizim. And Jesus says, the day is coming and now is when true worshipers will worship me in spirit, worship God in spirit and in truth. Amen. Those are the kind of worshipers that the Father seeks. Yes, amen. Oh, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Did you realize that God has created you to worship and to praise him? Y'all with me this morning? Amen. Amen. The Lord has created us to praise and to worship him. That's part of his will for our life. Amen. To me, on a Sunday morning, whenever we're having praise and worship, and these wonderful ladies are leading us in that, man, that's just like a highlight of my week.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
To praise the Lord, to lift up his name in praise. To worship him. To worship him. I got big hopes for this coming year. Can I share them with you? Just one. Talking about my wish, my desire. I wish that if it wasn't too big of a deal, that when that clock hit 10:35 and these ladies led us in prayer and started worshiping, that this place would be full.
Amen.
That we would all be able to just join right in, yeah, praising and worship the Lord. You know, it's fine. All of us that come and worship is fine. But the more that's added, man, it just creates a greater environment of praise and worship. You know, the Bible says that he inhabits the praises of his people.
Amen.
So if there's three people praising God, he's inhabiting those praises.
Amen.
Amen. But if there's 30 people, then he's inhabiting those praises as well.
Amen.
Praise and worship time here shouldn't be just some type of activity. All right? Oh, we just got to make it through this. You know? Oh, if I make it through this song, I make it through the next song. I don't even really like that song. That's too fast. That's too loud, too slow. I don't like the beat. I don't like the key. You know? Oh, it hurts my ears. Have we realized that our praise and worship, don't be mad at me, it's not for us. It's for him. It's for him. It's not an activity just to get through. Just to pass the time. It's not something we do to occupy the first 20 minutes of the service. No, it's something to get us in a place where we can worship the Lord. We can pour our hearts out to him and be ready to receive from him.
Yeah.
You know, there's a kind of a joke goes around pastors, JB, that a lot of bad preaching can be overcome by some good praise and worship. But if you got bad praise and worship, the best preaching can't do anything with it. We got some good praise and worship here. I love our ladies and what they do. They do a tremendous job. I know we'd have to rearrange some of our schedules, okay? I know it might take a little bit of extra effort, but it would be so pleasing to me that when 10:35 started and we had that prayer and worship, man, we were ready. Amen. We were ready to worship the Lord. Amen? We were ready to praise Him.
Amen.
Okay? Regardless of if it's fast or slow or if it's loud or if it's too soft, you know, but we're praising the Lord. I've got my eyes and my mind on Him, and I'm giving Him praise. He created those He formed. He had created them, formed them for Himself, that they might declare Me praise.
Amen.
That's why we're made. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Jesus says that the Father is seeking after true worshipers. He's looking for us. Praise God. Thank You, Lord. Oh, man. Where are we at? Number three. Number three was bearing fruit in every good work. Every good work. David, I don't know if I'm going to make it to 7 this morning. Every good work. That's a wide category. What is every good work? Bearing fruit in every good work. Well, you know, if the Lord has given you the gifting, if He's given you the opportunity to preach, get out there and preach. If He's given you the opportunity and the giftings to praise Him. If He's given you the opportunity and the giftings to show someone compassion, show them.
Amen.
Show them. Whatever it is that the Lord has given you to do, do it.
Amen.
Do it. Every good work. See, this takes into account even the little small things that we think really don't matter a whole lot. No, He says every good work.
Amen.
Showing somebody compassion. You know, you see somebody, you know, and your heart's moved because they're hungry, feed them. Feed them. Somebody that you know is hurting, pray for them.
Amen.
Whatever it is. Every good work is what He said. Bearing fruit in every good work. Whatever it is that the Lord is moving you to do, do it.
Amen.
Do it. May the Lord come to your tree. Find that fruit
Amen.
That He so desperately is looking for.
Amen.
Thank You, Lord. Growing in the knowledge of the Lord. Look at it. Verse 10. We pray this in order that you may live a life worthy of our Lord. That's number two. That you may please Him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work. That's number three. And number four, growing in the knowledge of God.
Amen.
Growing in the, and I don't know any other way that you can grow in the knowledge of God other than by this.
Amen.
That's the only way that I know that you can grow in the knowledge of God is by your Bible. Can I tell you another thing I'd love to have on my desire for 2021? It's when I see you come in here at 10:35, that you got one of these hanging by your side, all right? And you're so proud of it, you're swinging it. You want everybody to see it. I got my Bible. Where's your Bible? Man, I would love it that somebody come in here without a Bible, it would be an oddity. Where's your Bible? Amen? We're Christians. We're going to the house of the Lord. This ought to be just like, you know, your shoes that you're wearing. I can't go. I don't have my shoes. I can't go. I don't have my Bible. Amen? All this is your sword, guys. This is it. This is the key to life right here.
Amen.
And that's what Paul prays for these people. And I pray this for you guys, that you would have His knowledge, the knowledge of what? Of His Word. Growing in the knowledge of God. I ask you a question. How would you rate your knowledge of God right now? Just a rhetorical question. How would you rate your knowledge of God this morning? Second question, add to that. Where did you get most of your knowledge about God? Did you get it from what you heard other people say? Did you get it from somebody standing up on a stage? I tell you guys over and over and over, check what I say by the Word.
Amen.
If the two don't agree, then throw mine out. Okay? This is our standard. There's so much confusion in the body of Christ. There's so much people that are led astray, so much false doctrine out there because people don't know the Word.
Amen.
Oh, I've been amazed as you have too. You know, we hear all these people that are supposed prophets out there, and they're prophesying this and prophesying that, prophesying this. You know, people with pulpits, you know, where they're gathering in thousands upon thousands of people You know? And, you know, the Bible plainly tells us that if a thing doesn't come to pass, that person's a false prophet.
Yeah.
You're to cast them away and their message, okay? And I have been astounded. I saw a person who issued two apologies, but then later removed them from social media, a pastor, prominent pastor. He had prophesied over the presidency. Well, obviously that didn't pan out like he prophesied. He come out and issued an apology and saying that he didn't hear right. But then he said these words, and that troubled me more than anything. I would give him props for coming out and giving an apology, JB.
Amen.
Dad, it was great that he had the courage to get up there and say, you know, I said something that wasn't right. What really troubled me was he said, I'm not a false prophet, though.
No.
Are you kidding me? No. When I say that I'm a prophet, I'm saying the words that I'm about to speak are the same value as what's on these pages here. Because the Word of God won't change.
Yep.
And if what I tell you doesn't come to pass, then that's a false prophecy. And it's a false prophet that uttered it. And so that was so troublesome. And you see, there are people, you look at their thing, man, there's, you know, 10,000 views, 20,000 views, 100,000 views, 500,000 views. After these things have not come to pass. Why? Because we don't have a good knowledge of the Word. I'm here to tell you, God doesn't make any mistakes. He doesn't miss it, you know, by a little bit. He's never off, okay? He's never kind of right. Are you with me? You know, he doesn't get it wrong. Oh, I didn't see that coming. Oh, wow. I had no idea that they'd do that. That's not God. No. But man can. Man gets that wrong all the time. Amen. Well, that's probably enough on that. Amen. We would prevent a lot of that if we knew this better.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Very quickly. Being strengthened with all power according to His glorious might. If ever we needed the power of God, it's today.
Amen.
Thank the Lord that He's given us His power. Being strengthened with all power according to His glorious might. Number 6, so that you may have great endurance and patience. How many of you need patience today?
Amen.
You need endurance today.
Amen.
Pray that over yourself. Pray that over others. Very quickly. Number 7. Verse 12. Paul prays that they would give thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the kingdom of light. For He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness, brought us into the kingdom of His Son He loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sin. He says that God Himself has qualified you. See, it's not my works that qualify me. It's God that has qualified me. And what has He qualified me for? What's He qualified you for as a believer? He's qualified us for an inheritance. God's qualified us, meaning that I don't work for a wage. You see, the inheritance is not something you work for. Inheritance is something that God has granted us. That God, the Bible says, He's qualified us for that. And then he goes on speaking about the fact that He brought us out of darkness. He's redeemed us. And the idea of redemption, you see, is the fact of putting something away. It's buying something with a legal ransom, but then having something put away as well, the forgiveness. So ransom and forgiveness. Redemption and putting it away. Those two things are connected together. What has He done? All the precious blood of Christ has redeemed us. He's bought us back with a legal ransom. And you know what He's done with our sin? He's carried it away just like it never existed.
Amen.
He's put it far away. Now, to understand that, on the Day of Atonement in Israel, whenever the high priest Aaron would go into the Holy of Holies, the only time he could, he would go in there and he'd take a bull for his own sins. And he would go into the holy place after he had lit the altar of incense and filled that holy place full of smoke lest he die. He would go in there and he would take his finger and he would sprinkle 7 drops of blood. He sprinkled 7 times on the east side of the mercy seat there, the lid of the Ark of the Covenant. He would make his own atonement there by the bull, purge his own sin because he was coming into the presence of Holy God, so he needed to make a sacrifice.
Amen.
So that was his. But then he made a sacrifice for the people. And you know what he did? He took two goats. And he brought them before the Lord. And Aaron would cast lots. In other words, he would kind of like, you know, pick straws or roll the dice. And one goat, whichever one it fell on, would be the Lord's. And the other goat would be the goat called the scapegoat. Y'all heard about the scapegoat before? This is where it gets its origin from. Well, the goat that was the Lord's, this goat here would be, Aaron would put his hands over this goat. The sins of the people would be pronounced over this goat. That goat would be killed. He would be slain over there and burned up as a sin offering. That was the offering for the people. He would take the blood of that goat and sprinkle it on the altar 7 times for the people. The scapegoat is what's very unique. Aaron would come out, he'd put both hands on that goat, and he would announce the sins of all the people there in Israel. And it was symbolically by placing them on that goat, by putting his hands there. And then they would have a person from the camp that would come and take that goat away. The rabbis say they would take that goat about 10 miles out into the wilderness, Dad, and let him go. And he would never again come back to the camp. Amen. What was that symbolic of? It's the sins of the people being carried out of the camp. But here's the thing. In Israel, that animal was left to live. They didn't kill him. It's possible he might have wandered back into the camp one day. It got to be such a possibility that they tied a scarlet thread on that on the horns of that goat so they know it if he could ever come back into the camp. Here's the thing. Those sins were just carried away. They were never actually paid for. They were just kind of covered in a way. But you see, it was when Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, went to the cross and shed his blood that our sins were no longer just carried away, no longer alive, but those sins actually killed the sacrifice, Jesus. So now for me and you, not only have our sins been dealt with, yes, not only has a ransom been paid by his precious blood, but you know what? They're never going to return. Why? Because God has paid for them through the price of his precious son, his blood, on Calvary's cross. It took the life of Jesus Christ. We never have to worry about our sins ever resurfacing again. Once they're forgiven, guess what? They're dealt with. God's forgot them as far as he's concerned. We might remember them. Satan will bring them back up in our mind. But as God's concerned, they're dealt with. Just like the scapegoat, except not alive, but dead. Not going to wander back into the camp. Not going to bring it back up in front of you. That's the privilege that God has given us by his precious son. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now let me close with this. I appreciate you guys giving me an extra minute or two. How do we respond to the Lord? What's our attitude going into this year? You know, all these things that we've talked about, they may not ever transpire if we don't realize the importance of God in our life, to me and you. Not to Rick, not to the worship team, not to the church, but to you. That's what's important. What does it mean between you and God? What does it mean for you to know his will? To have his wisdom? To be pleasing to the Lord? What does it mean? A little boy would go to bed and feel something on his feet. He realized it was his little puppy because the little puppy would jump up in the bed with him at night. And when the little boy would have to go to the bathroom, he'd get up and the little puppy would get down from the bed, and while the boy was in the bathroom, the little puppy would sit down there by the door. When the boy got out of the bathroom, he'd follow the little boy, jump right back up in the bed, and be right there at his feet, tail just a wagging. The little boy would get up, go to breakfast. The dog would get up out of bed, follow the boy into the kitchen, and he would sit down right there by the breakfast table, watching the little boy eat, tail just a wagging. Little boy would be time to go to school, so he'd get out and he'd go to the bus stop. The dog would come and follow the little boy. And the boy would get on the school bus, and the dog didn't go, but the dog would follow the bus as far away as he could go, you know, until he finally gave out. And then when the little boy come back from school, guess who was waiting for him? The little dog. And he'd go back. Little boy would have to get a bath. Dog would be outside the door waiting for him. And then by the time to go to bed, the whole scenario started all over again. See, why did that little dog pay such attention to that boy? The boy that he obviously loved by the wagging of his tail. You see, that little boy had found that dog in a pound, and he'd rescued that dog. And, you know, if it wasn't for that boy finding that dog in that pound and bringing him back, feeding him, nursing him back to health, making him his own, giving him a home, that little dog would have been destroyed. And you see, it seems illogical, but there's something in that little precious dog's mind that tied him to that boy as a rescuer. The one that showed him favor, showed him love and care. And he never forgot it, signaled by the wagging of that tail. Well, that's nice, Rick, but what does that mean for me and you? Where did God find you? Where did God find me? Now, the Lord found me on the streets of sin. There's some of us that he finds in the streets of sin. And you know, as he finds us there, sometimes, you know, we're doing things that nobody knows about. But if the secret closet was opened up, we'd be so embarrassed. Some people do things that's sinful and really don't know any better. Some people do sinful things out there, and, you know, they don't care if anybody knows. They're just really in the open. But wherever it is that we were there, guess what? The Lord Jesus comes in there and he pulls us out of that slime, out of the streets of sin. And you know what? He redeems us. He pays the price. He cleans us up. He washes us. He gives us a lot to eat, nurses us back to health. And you see, here's the thing. After realizing how far he's brought us from, I don't know if you ever think about that. Where did God bring you from? Where are you at now? Where did he bring you from? Are we like the little boy and the dog? Are we so appreciative of what Jesus has done for us, where he has brought us from, that we are tied uniquely to him? Every move that he makes, I want to be there. Lord, whatever it is that you have for me, I want to do it. Lord, what do you want me to do today? Amen. What do you want me to do this week, Lord? You see, that's the type of relationship I believe the Lord desires of us. To have that unique bond between one that's been rescued and the one who rescued, the rescuer, Jesus Christ. So I ask you, do you have that bond with him today? Are you so appreciative of where he's brought you and where you are that you'll never forget it? To me, that's the true worshiper, one that worships him in spirit and in truth. I'll be praying these things for you. I ask that you pray them for me. As well. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you so much, God, for being with us this morning. Thank you, Lord, for this precious prayer of Paul that we have to be able to examine, to apply it to our lives this morning. And Lord, I pray that you would just stir our hearts to see anywhere where we may be lacking, anywhere there was emptiness, that there's a desire for these things to take place in our life. Lord, that each one of us would desire to be filled with the knowledge of your will. Lord, that each one of us would desire for ourselves to have a greater knowledge of your word. Lord, that we would bear fruit that's pleasing to you. Lord, we'd go down this list of these seven. And we see these things and we would pray them over ourselves. Pray them for pastor. Pray them for others that we may not even realize their name. But Lord, you drop them into our heart. We pray it over this church, Lord, all these seven. And Lord, I pray over these precious people of yours, Lord, people that you have purposed and created, gifted. Lord, that they would be filled with your knowledge of your will for their life. Get involved with it. Live a life pleasing to you, Lord, worthy of your name. Forever grateful of the redemption that you've granted them. And Lord, this coming year, that be a blessed year for each one of us. No matter the circumstances that we may face, Lord, we're given the endurance and the patience and out of these prayers to be able to deal with whatever comes our way. Lord, you'll be with us every single day. Lord, our prayer is that we be with you. Lord, bless our families. Bless our church. Bless our community. Lord, we give you all the praise in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Everybody said amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Praise the Lord. God bless you guys. I love y'all. If I don't see you Wednesday, we will see you certainly next year. Amen.